The title of my paper happens to be Dalits under the governance, decentralized governance system. In my presentation, I propose to argue that decentralized governance system provides opportunities for the Dalits to empower themselves socially, economically, and politically. Let me elaborate these points in detail. You will all know that Indian society is a highly stratified society. It is graded and hierarchical in nature. And in this hierarchy, Dalits occupy the lowest, you know, position in the society. As a result, Dalits are discriminated, they are abused, and they are also humiliated. The solution suggested by some scholars for this problem was that Dalits may be empowered first economically so that they have control over economic resources, and the control over economic resources will enable them to lead a reasonably dignified life. Secondly, it is also suggested that politically the Dalits should be empowered in the sense that they should be provided opportunities to participate in the decision-making process in the political bodies so that the Dalits or Dalit leaders will be in a position to identify the needs and aspirations of that their community and meet those needs and aspirations. And finally, it is also suggested that Dalits may be socially empowered such that they are in a better position to challenge the traditional notions and traditional beliefs, and also to negotiate with the society for a dignified life for themselves. Now, following this, I think we have some provisions in the Constitution. The Constitution of India made some provisions for empowering the Dalits. The Dalits were assured affirmative action in the sense that government jobs and seats in colleges, higher education institutions, were reserved for them, with the understanding that the Dalits would be able to equip themselves with skills and capabilities and then participate in the economic development of the country. And also it was believed that government jobs not only come with better incomes, but government jobs also bring a better social status for those who hold those jobs. The second provision happens to be that the Dalits should have a quota in the political institutions, particularly legislature and parliament, so that they could participate actively in the decision-making process at the governmental level. And finally, the Constitution also prohibited the practice of untouchability, atrocities, and so on. So these provisions were expected to or believed to improve the social and economic conditions of the Dalits. But the history of the implementation of these provisions suggests that these provisions could not make a significant dent into the rural power structure, because rural power structure remained untouched for the simple reason that the government jobs, Dalit did overtime, but then government jobs were in urban areas, so people shifted to urban areas. Then parliament and legislature were far away from the people, far away from the rural areas where their representatives were representing them. Consequently, rural power structure remained untouched. And the result is that that did not improve the socio-economic conditions of the Dalits. Fortunately, in the 80s and subsequently in many states 90s, decentralized governments were put in place, more particularly rural governments, in the form of panchayats, were established, and the panchayats had made a provision, the Panchayat Act made a provision that Dalits should have a quota, not only in the membership of the panchayats, elected membership in the panchayats, but also in the authority positions, namely presidentship and vice presidentship of the Gram Panchayat, Taluk Panchayat, and Zilla Panchayat. Now these provisions enabled the Dalits to contest election without facing competition in election from the dominant community members who were more powerful socially and economically. So they easily got elected, and the elected representatives of Dalits brought political legitimacy to their community. That is one point which we should remember, that decentralized governments provided political legitimacy. Number two, the number of Dalit members who were elected to the panchayats were equal to their population, and their population varied from 20 to 24, 25%, and therefore 20 to 24% of the Dalits were elected to panchayats, and this number actually provided the necessary bargaining power to the Dalits, elected members of the Dalit community. And what kind of bargaining power? That if the dominant community members wanted to occupy authority positions, they needed the support of the Dalit members, whose numbers were significantly large. So they could bargain with them. Now look, we give you support, but then you need to take care of our community. So that kind of a thing emerged. Therefore, the political legitimacy, as also the bargaining power which they acquired in the political field in the rural areas, actually, worked towards altering the rural power structure. And that is, I think, one of the greatest things that has happened in recent times in the rural society. Political power structure has been altered altered in favor of Dalits. Now, this had such unfavorable consequences. Consequence number one, that Dalit leaders were in a position to obtain the required benefits from the state, which would meet the needs and aspirations of the Dalit community members. And this was further facilitated by the fact that the Panchayat Act had made it mandatory that the panchayats needed to spend a proportion of the budget which is in proportion to the population of that community. So it definitely brought a lot of benefits to the Dalits in the rural areas in the form of housing, in the form of sanitation facility, drinking water facility, electricity supply, streets, paved streets, roads connecting Dalit colony with other towns and cities, and so on, which improved the living conditions of the Dalit community members. As a result, the Dalits no longer needed to go to the doorsteps of the dominant community people for anything. The Dalits no longer wanted to make use of the water from the common wells used by the dominant communities, because they were prohibited from taking water from the common source of water. They were not allowed entry into temples. They were not allowed to participate in the village festivals and so on and so forth. But now that the economic condition and political condition of the Dalits improved significantly, they were able to, number one, have their own source of water, borewells, for example, in their own colony. Number two, they also voluntarily contributed and constructed their own temples in their colony. So they didn't have to go to the village deity, they had their own deity. And then they need not go to the dominant community doorsteps seeking jobs and other benefits, because they had what? The Mahatma Gandhi Rural Guarantee, Employment Guarantee Program, and many other programs had provided employment opportunities for them, and many of them having been educated had been traveling from villages to nearby towns for work, and therefore their dependence on dominant communities was reduced to the significant extent. Hence, the Dalits did not feel it necessary to challenge the traditional beliefs and notions which were handed down for centuries. The kind of relationship that obtains between the Dalits and others in the villages is a relationship which I would like to say respectful distance. The situation confines itself to Karnataka, not beyond. I don't know in other state whatever is happening. The propositions which I have presented are propositions which I have derived by my observation in the field. Whenever I went to field for my projects, this is what I have, you know, derived. And I also carried out a survey of my own village, you know, and so I know that these are based on my observations. But I would urge this community which is over here to ascertain the veracity of the propositions which I have presented. And then ascertain them by carrying out a formal research study. Since my time is up, I would like to thank the chairman and also the audience for their time. Thank you very much.